Well, Joshua?
Yeah, Moses.
There it is. There it is. The River Jordan. Oh, we finally made it. After all these years, 40 years wandering in the wilderness, but I won't be able to go with you the last leg into the promised land, but you will. You'll be able to go. You'll be able to lead the people.
So you didn't know Dallas was the promised land, did you, huh? No wonder I love it so much. Well, our scripture reading for today comes from the first chapter of Joshua. We read the first few verses last time, and then today we're going to be reading verses 6 through 9. So Joshua chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. But first, may we pray. Eternal God, we are thankful that you are a God who wants to speak to us, that you are a God who wants to have a personal relationship with us, and that you want to speak to us through your word. Open our hearts, open our minds, open our ears to hear what you have to say to each of us this day. We ask these prayers in thy loving and awesome name. Amen. So, Joshua 1, beginning in verse 6. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them. Only be strong and very courageous. Be careful to act in accordance with all the law that my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from it from the right hand or the left, so that you may be successful wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. Verse 9, I hereby command you, Joshua, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen. Today's scripture reading continues the reading from last week. The book of Joshua begins immediately with a downer by announcing that Moses had died. 40 years have passed since Moses led them out of Egypt. Upon the death of Moses, the mantle of leadership was passed from me to Wesley. I mean, from Moses to Joshua, who now both these guys belong to the Israelite versions of AARP or AMAC. Joshua, Caleb, and those Israelites who were younger than 20 years old, that is back at Kadesh Barnea, and now 40 years more than that, are younger than 60 years old, they would be the ones allowed to enter the promised land. These people are the children of those who escaped Egypt. The second generation of Israelites is standing on the east side of the Trinity River, the River Jordan, and God commands Joshua to go. What could have stopped Joshua and the Israelites from rushing into the water immediately? Fear. They probably felt the fear of their parents rising within them. Their job, though, is to conquer their fear and to cross the river. With God's help, you and I need to conquer our fears as we stand on the banks separating us from our promised land. Amen. Matt Miaski identifies in his book a few of these many fears. As was discussed last week, the first fear is the fear of loss. The fear of loss. The fear of loss is our instinct to avoid grief for ourselves and to shield others from it. A second fear is the fear of failure. The fear of failure hinders our attempts to manage our own change. As I've been preaching at the contemporary service on Saturday nights at 5 o'clock, we play the what if game with ourselves. What if I take a risk or want to follow a Holy Spirit-inspired change in my life and, you know, it doesn't work out? Or what if I don't have what it takes? Or what if people don't like me? What if I don't meet the expectations that other people have for me? What if I don't meet the expectations that I have of myself? The older that we get, the more that we have to lose. But if our goal becomes not failing, then we forever are playing a defensive game in life. This goal keeps us from the abundant life that God wants for us, the overflowing kind of life that God imagines for us. We most clearly see the fear of failure in the first generation of the Israelites 39 years earlier when they were afraid of continuing to the new beginning of the promised land. Why? Well, because all they could see was what was going to go wrong, rather than what could go right. But what about the second generation? Would they allow their parents' fear to influence them and to win? Joshua had to keep them focused on the vision. The vision is the picture of the future that God had imagined for them. The more that they focused on the vision, the less time they had to focus on their fears of what might happen if they failed. Ultimately, Joshua's tactic worked, and he was able, as you know, to lead them across the River Jordan into the promised land. Perhaps they all knew too well from watching their parents that the fear of failing was not worth giving up what God had prepared for them. Our fear of failure comes from a fundamentally false assumption that failure is always bad and that failure only hurts us. Most of us, when we are able, you know, to look back at the moments of failure in our lives, can recognize that even in those worst case scenarios, we learned, we grew, we were shaped by God and prepared for the future. We simply overestimate the cost of failing and we underestimate the cost of never trying. We need to keep focused on the vision and see what we could win by trying. The third fear is the fear of commitment. We fear missing out. Economists quantify this as a fear of opportunity cost. Opportunity cost. You planted wheat, but you could have planted cotton. The misunderstanding begins with a misconception about commitment. We think of commitment as restrictive, you know, as what we can't do or as things, you know, being taken away from us. You know, well, if I pick this option over here, then I'm going to miss out on this option over here. And so decisions, you know, are hard. Decisions can seem so decisive. I knew a wife who was sick and tired of her husband being so definite. Definite is a word related to decisive. She told him finally at her wit's end, "Why do you have to be so definite about everything?" The husband, my father, replied, "I tell you this one thing, I am definitely not definite." She said, "That's stupid," she said. When we perennially attempt to keep our options open to all things, we ensure that we will miss out on everything. The fear of missing out oddly leads to missing out. To keep our options open, we miss out on the best opportunities that God presents to us. This dynamic was part of what happened to the first generation of Israelites when they started circling in the desert, analyzing, considering, taking a little more time. Circling around the wilderness yet one more time was easier for them than was crossing the River Jordan. Committing to crossing the river, deciding to go for it, always seemed so definite. They literally died because they couldn't decide that maybe today would be the day to go for it by obeying God. And a fourth fear is the fear of criticism. The fear of criticism is the fear of what people might think of us because of the decisions that we make or the path that we choose to follow in our lives. On the east bank of the River Jordan that day, Joshua had to convince the second generation Israelites that nothing truly great was accomplished without criticism and the snickers of a peanut gallery. Or the way that social media puts it, haters are going to hate. When you step out and try something new in your life, or when you, through prayerful discernment, decide to follow a call that you believe is from God, your decision is going to look silly or worse to a few people in your life. Last Sunday was the Blessing of the Backpacks Sunday. Our children's minister, Katie McKnight, in her blessing, she recited a verse from Joshua chapter 1. I later thanked her at staff meeting for including a verse from Joshua 1, which was the chapter from which the scripture reading for the sermon came. She said that she did not know at that point that Joshua 1 would be the day's chapter. We both agreed, though, that God did. In a similar vein, when I planned months ago on preaching this sermon about the River Jordan, I did not realize that I was going to present this following important story today. Today is August the 20th. 35 years ago today, that is August 20th, 1988, I first felt God call me to become a pastor. On that day, August 20th, 1988, I had a knowing that I know that I know that God is calling. I thought of, this is long before social media, I thought of how I would present this news. And believe it or not, I was afraid of telling my father. My father was not a mean man or a stern man, but I assumed that my father had so many expectations of me that he would be critical of me if I did not meet those expectations. Exactly a year earlier, TCU graduated me with a business degree. before TCU, Baylor graduated me with a degree in business and radio television. I chose business both times because my father was a businessman his whole life. Some pastors come from a line of pastors, or at least had a distant relative who was a pastor. As far as I knew, my being a pastor was not on any radar of family. Becoming a pastor would require my returning to private school, which, as a businessman, my father knew would be expensive. Going to seminary would mean that I would be without a full-time salary for 5 years. My father was not the type of person to think out loud, possibly because he was an executive manager of other people. Whenever a family member had a proposal, we had to come up with as many specifics and be ready to present those to him. After I gathered as much information about the ordination process, seminary costs, funding, and expected pastoral salaries, I was a little less fearful in approaching him. So how did my father react to my saying that I wanted to respond affirmatively to God's call to become a pastor? I don't know. I don't remember. I think that he was somewhat surprised, but he was not critical. Two years later, when I started my student appointment at Oak Grove, he deliberately waited a few months to allow me to get some earth under my feet before coming out to hear me. And he soon became very supportive of my being a pastor. That picture, by the way, of the two of us, that was taken on the day that I proposed to Nicole. So, other than some dear Baptist friends who, when I told them that I wanted to serve as a pastor, replied, "Well, why do you want to do that?" Everybody else was happy and supportive, not critical. But years later, those Baptist friends traveled all the way from Georgia to attend my ordination. Regarding your pondering about a transition to your promised land, do not ignore all the sound advice and close yourself off from the perspective of friends. Matt Miofsky writes, "Do not let the opinions of others be the guiding principle of your journey. Needing to please others, avoid criticism, or assuage critics is not a good way to make decisions. All this will do is ensure that you are on the wide, crowded, and easy road, one that leads to nothing new, nothing interesting, and nothing truly creative." Throughout this 12-sermon series, the longest one that I've ever preached, you have seen some graphic if you watch the edited version of the sermon on Facebook or YouTube. One shows this background that for the Matt Miofsky quotations. It shows the silhouette of a skydiver. Who's gone skydiving in here? Raise your hand. Bless you. And you're here today, so that's excellent. Okay. Well, a skydiver is someone who deliberately lets go. And this guy, when he jumped, probably felt an adrenaline rush. The skydiver is falling from thousands of feet in the air, is awaiting the right time to open his parachute, will slow the descent, and then will land safely on the ground. The other graphic, that for the sermon series, shows a door that is only slightly open and implies that someone is about to lean into the doorway to see if he or she wants to enter. The cover of the worship guide, and also as you can see on your insert there, shows a person's hand about ready to enter whatever is on the other side of the door. What's on the other side of the door? Ooh. What does it take to jump out of an airplane, or to a much lesser extent, to open a door that goes to who knows where? Courage. Courage means, among other things, allowing yourself to let go and to get loose and to move forward and thus gain new realities in your life. What did it take for Joshua to lead the Israelites into the promised land? Courage. In fact, God commanded Joshua to have courage. Look at verse 1:6. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I, the Lord, swore to their ancestors to give them. Joshua had to be strong and courageous, and he was. He led them into the promised land of Canaan. What does it take to overcome the fear of loss? Courage. Courage is allowing yourself to feel hurt, to process it, and to move through it while trusting that God has something prepared for you. Courage is not allowing your fear of loss, to hold you back from moving forward. Courage is leading people to name their loss, allowing them to grieve, and then not trying to fix the loss. What does it take to overcome the fear of failure? Courage. Courage is recognizing that failure, yes, is a real possibility, and yet stepping out all the while trusting that God can indeed weave together all that we do for our ultimate good. Courage is recognizing that in God's care and by his grace, painful failure also is a refining process that shapes us. Because God is our branch, learned about how God is the refiner for us, and failure helps us. Courage is keeping our eyes focused on what we could win by trusting and letting go. What does it take to overcome the fear of commitment? Courage. Courage is letting go of the fear of missing out. Courage is the ability to tune out other options. Courage is recognizing that the only way to have a meaningful living is by making intentional choices to do what we believe that God is calling us to do. What does it take for the fear of criticism? Let me hear it. Oh, y'all are good. Courage, yes. Courage. Courage is recognizing that sometimes you cannot be concerned with pleasing all the people around you or avoiding looking foolish to the people whom you respect. Sometimes the right thing, the authentic thing, the faithful decision is a lonely one. Courage is the willingness to do it anyway. When you hear God's call to Joshua to be strong and courageous, I hope that you apply those words to you. There is a journey ahead of you, and God wants to lead you. Change might feel like more than you can bear, but with God's help, you got this. You can do this. This is what it feels like to manage God-inspired change in healthy transition in life. You are not alone in your journey to the promised land. Amen. So God calls us to move forward. Look at verse 9. For the Lord told Joshua. And Katie told the children, I hereby command you, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. May we pray. Heavenly Father, today we receive your word, which is life, health, and strength to us. And you are telling us not to be afraid. So thank you, Lord, for giving us the strength to stand strong against fear. We choose to close the door on fear by guarding what we say, to what we listen, and on what we dwell. May we take you on your word and trust in you as we lean into the future without fear. And by your grace, may we be strong and courageous. Amen.
Let's go ahead and stand together. Been really special to be with each other today. Amen. We appreciate you letting us share our music with you. We know that the Lord inhabits the praises of his people, no matter what it sounds like, no matter what instrument. We're all instruments of the Lord, amen? So we're going to sing a song. You should know the words to this song. We're going to sing the Lord's Prayer. So let's just worship the Lord together. If you need prayer, we have some people in the back that would really love to pray with you, including Pastor John. So feel free to move out from amongst your seats and join them in prayer.
Thank you.
from the Israelites' identity and their purpose to their future vision had undergone a transition in the wilderness. Something happened to the second generation of Israelites when Joshua led them across the River Jordan into the promised land, and that is that they were no longer thought of as Egyptian slaves, but as God's chosen people. The rest of the Old Testament continues their becoming and living out this identity. The New Testament tells how we Christians have been grafted into that vine. And know, please know, KNOW, that there is a destination to which God is leading you. The journey itself makes you into the person God created you to be. So, church, God is telling you today to not be afraid. Are you going to trust God at His word? And God will be with you and is with you even when you look around and things don't seem to look good. God will be with you in that storm. So keep believing, keep trusting, and be strong and never give up. So thank you for joining us for worship this One Church Sunday. And I'm going to close with the benediction. And then after which, you will see on the screen four specific action steps that you can take in response to this message. So take to heart what the Lord told to Joshua, and He tells us, and may this be our benediction. I hereby command you to be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen.
You could go farther that way.
Okay.
Okay. So a little more that way. Okay, and then a little back. Okay, so stop. Okay. Then I'm gonna go. Yeah. Yeah, that'd be cool. Okay.